Morning, students. Continuing the gastroenterologic topics, today's class is on hepatic encephalopathy. I am Dr. Karthik, Assistant Professor, Department of General Medicine, Gayatri Vidya Parishad Medical College. Hope all of you are fine at your home. So, what are the learning objectives for today's class? In today's class, at the end of today's class, you should be able to define hepatic encephalopathy. Describe the pathophysiology of hepatic encephalopathy. List the clinical features of hepatic encephalopathy. Describe the differential diagnosis of hepatic encephalopathy. And finally, describe the management of hepatic encephalopathy. So, coming to the definition of hepatic encephalopathy. Hepatic encephalopathy is a neuropsychiatric symptom which occurs as a result of liver cell failure. So it is a neuropsychiatric symptom, meaning it has both psychiatric symptoms as well as neurological symptoms and is always associated with liver cell failure. And most of the times it is a reversible condition. Patients usually have episodic or acute hepatic encephalopathy. It is usually reversible with treatment. And it mostly occurs in 50 to 70% of patients with cirrhosis. Occurrence of hepatic encephalopathy is of course a poor prognostic indicator for the liver disease for the patient. So after an episode of hepatic encephalopathy, the survival rates at 1 year and 3 years are 42% and 23%. So the range of symptoms in hepatic encephalopathy can be neurocognitive disturbances with mild in nature or to an overt coma. So there is a varied symptoms of hepatic encephalopathy, which is a spectrum. The symptoms may range from mild symptoms to coma. So in patients with cirrhosis, hepatic encephalopathy is often triggered by an inciting agent. So in chronic liver disease, especially in cirrhosis, the hepatic encephalopathy may be triggered by an inciting event. So we'll look at the details of all these things in the coming slides. So we all know, so liver can be subjected to an acute insult or a chronic insult. So an acute insult, like infections with viruses like hepatitis A, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, or in the presence of alcohol, it may cause acute hepatitis. Sometimes the acute hepatitis may lead to fulminant hepatitis, where hepatic failure ensues within 8 weeks of onset of the symptoms. And it may lead to chronic diseases like cirrhosis. So hepatitis B infection, hepatitis C infection, or alcoholic liver disease may produce chronic insult, producing the cirrhosis of the liver. So viral hepatitis, alcoholic hepatitis, and drug reactions and overdose may cause acute insult to the liver, producing acute hepatitis. Whereas chronic insult like hepatitis B, hepatitis D, alcoholic liver disease, or some autoimmune disease may produce cirrhosis of liver. So both acute and chronic liver cell failure may lead to hepatic encephalopathy. In acute liver cell failure, the acute hepatitis itself is the cause for hepatic encephalopathy, and hepatic cell failure occurs and then there is hepatic encephalopathy. However, in chronic disease like cirrhosis of liver, there are some precipitants which cause the occurrence of hepatic encephalopathy. The precipitants could be diuresis, that is excess of diuretics or presence of an hemorrhage. Patients who are presenting with portal hypertension, esophageal varices can may have upper GI bleed or excessive paracentesis. Patient with diarrhea and vomiting, patient who has undergone any surgery, or if there is any alcohol excess or any use of sedatives, infections, and if there is prolonged constipation, and if there is any portal systemic shunting. We all know in the treatment of cirrhosis, to reduce the portal hypertension, there is a procedure called TIPS, transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunting. So this shunting may lead to precipitate hepatic encephalopathy. And similarly, excess dietary protein intake. So the main pathophysiology in hepatic encephalopathy is a pre-existing liver failure, such as a chronic liver disease with a precipitant factor. And there is shunting of blood from portal system to systemic circulation. In acute hepatitis, because of the acute liver cell failure, it leads to hepatic encephalopathy. In fact, hepatic encephalopathy is one of the criteria for liver transplantation. So there is an indication for liver transplantation in fulminant hepatitis. So we look at the pathophysiology of hepatic encephalopathy. So as we all know, the nitrogenous waste which occurs in the which is obtained, which is absorbed from the intestine through the dietary food proteins or through any blood which is accumulated in the intestine, such as any GI bleed, or through drugs and bacterial action, whenever there is nitrogen, it is converted into ammonia. This ammonia must be detoxified. This the ammonia goes via the portal circulation into the liver and gets detoxified via urea cycle, and the urea is excreted in the urine. So the normally the blood which reaches the systemic circulation does not contain any amount of ammonia. However, whenever there is hepatocellular disease like acute liver cell failure, acute hepatitis, or cirrhosis of liver, then the urea cycle is absent. So there is no detoxification of ammonia. This ammonia goes into the systemic circulation, and this systemic circulation ammonia reaches the brain. So ammonia is neurotoxic. So it directly impinges on the brain and produces a variety of manifestations. This cerebral disturbance is manifested clinically as hepatic encephalopathy. As you can see the same in the flowchart, the patient with cirrhosis with portal hypertension, so there is obviously there is inflammation, vasoactive mediators are present, and there is inflammation leading to splanchnic and peripheral vasodilatation. So this causes portosystemic shunting. So the blood which is flowing from the portal vein, the liver is not functional. It is the liver cell has failed. So the blood is shunted towards the systemic circulation without undergoing any changes. So this leads to elevation of ammonia levels in the blood. So and similarly, due to the inflammation and the direct action of ammonia as well, there is increased permeability of blood-brain barrier. All this leads to elevated ammonia levels in the brain, leading to edema of the brain, swelling of the astrocyte. Astrocytes form an important part of the blood-brain barrier, and leading to certain alterations in the neurotransmitters like glutamine, glycine, and GABA. So there is altered brain glucose metabolism. All these lead to certain manifestations which are together called as hepatic encephalopathy. So we have seen that because the ammonia is not detoxified into urea, and there is increase in the levels of ammonia in the blood which go into the cerebral circulation and cause all these effects. So how does the ammonia increased level of ammonia act? So how does it occur? So there is intestinal protein or bacteria which produces the ammonia. Because of the reduced hepatic removal, the ammonium levels increase in the blood. And similarly, the ammonia increase in cirrhosis of liver and chronic liver disease, there is decreased muscle mass. So usually the ammonia gets metabolized in the muscle. So whenever there is reduced muscle metabolism, it also leads to increased ammonium levels in the blood. So this ammonia crosses the blood-brain barrier and causes the damage to astrocyte. So what happens? So in astrocyte, the glutamate is converted into glutamine by amidation, that is addition of ammonia. So as ammonia levels increase and it crosses the blood-brain barrier and reaches the astrocyte, there is increased amidation of the glutamate into glutamine. This glutamine is again converted to glutamate in the neuron, and glutamate acts as a neurotransmitter at the receptor. So increase in the glutamine levels are observed. Similarly, the direct effects of ammonia, it alters the balance between excitatory and inhibitory neurotransmitters. That is, there is decrease in the excitatory neurotransmitters and increase in the decreased inhibitory activity, and also increased inhibitory neurotransmitters like GABA. So all these manifestations contribute to varied effects on the cerebral structures, leading to hepatic encephalopathy. So not only ammonia, the gut-derived toxins, there are certain toxins which are called gut-derived toxins. Though ammonia plays a major role, it acts as a direct neural toxin. Other substances like tryptophan, because of decreased metabolites of tryptophan, there is decreased serotonin. Serotonin is responsible for arousal. So because of lack of serotonin, there is altered arousal pattern. And similarly, there are some false neurotransmitters. There is decreased dopamine levels observed in the brains of hepatic encephalopathy. We all know dopamine is important for awareness, motor, and cognitive function. The decreased dopamine levels decrease to slowing of the motor activity. And similarly, just like Parkinson's disease, where there is decreased dopamine levels, it may produce some extrapyramidal effects like rigidity, slowness, and bradykinesia. and tremor. Similarly, there is increased GABA transmission. We all know GABA acts from pharmacology. You have learned that GABA acts at the chloride channel. The GABA receptor is also a receptor for the benzodiazepines. So all these act to increase the inflow of chloride ions, leading to hyperpolarization, which is inhibitory. And similarly, it decreases the glutamate. So increase in the inhibitory, decrease in the glutamate, and all these other neurotransmitters, alteration in the neurotransmitters lead to what is called as encephalopathy. So the predominant areas which are affected because of all these neurotoxins are the cortex. We all know cortex is responsible for the cognitive function. So when cortex is affected, there is decreased cognitive function. It may be mild. When it is severe, patient goes into coma. Similarly, basal ganglion is affected. In the basal ganglion, you have all the extrapyramidal, all the structures responsible for the extrapyramidal effects. So in the basal ganglion, there is the effects of encephalopathy and basal ganglion, which has decreased dopamine, will lead to rigidity, decreased brevity of the movement, decrease in the movement, and tremor. Similarly, cerebellum. Cerebellum is also affected. So we all know cerebellum is responsible for the balance. So when cerebellum is affected, there is ataxia, there is gait disturbances, there is slurring of the speech. So all these manifestations occur in hepatic encephalopathy. So this is the pathophysiology. We have seen that the main pathophysiological phenomena is increased levels of ammonium, which acts as a neural toxin. Other ancillary alterations in the neurotransmitters also contribute to hepatic encephalopathy. So what are the clinical manifestations of hepatic encephalopathy? So as we have seen, it is a spectrum. So it may range from mild changes to coma. So usually disturbances are observed in consciousness, intellectual impairment, there are some personality changes, and there are some speech abnormalities. So in patients with hepatic encephalopathy, a characteristic odor is observed called as foetal hepaticus. It is a sour fecal smell. So mercaptans, these are metabolites which are released into portal circulations, which are usually detoxified by the liver. In the absence of liver, these are excreted via the lung. So these produce the foetal hepaticus. So the symptoms may range from mild cognitive changes, mild intellectual impairment, and personality changes. Personality changes may be in the form of lack of interest, lack of concern towards family members. Okay, so there may be slight confusion. Patient may lack attention. Patient may have euphoria, or patient may be depressed. And in very mild conditions, there are no apparent clinical features, and the changes can only be observed by examination. The patient may have constructional apraxia. That is, patient is unable to reproduce a figure which is given to him to draw, or patient may not be able to connect the dots of the diagram. This is called constructional apraxia. So these are seen in very mild phase. However, this may lead to progressive changes leading to drowsiness, confusion, and ultimately coma. So this is a patient with mild hepatic encephalopathy. The patient is clinically normal, but when you ask him to draw a star, he draws in this pattern. And there is also slowing on haziness of writing. So all these are observed in mild hepatic encephalopathy. Similarly, there is a test called number connection test. So in which we ask the patient to connect the dot, to connect a numbers in the serial order, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the time taken by the patient increases. So if the patient is apparently normal, he may have these manifestations which may indicate patient is having mild hepatic encephalopathy. Especially in a patient with cirrhosis, you have to do all these tests. So to identify the subtle pattern of hepatic encephalopathy, clinically you can do what is called as psychometric hepatic encephalopathy score. It is a 5-paper and pencil test. The sensitivity of 96% and 100% specificity for the diagnosis of grade 1 hepatic encephalopathy. So it consists of 5 tests. Similar to the previous slide, there are 2 number connection tests. Where you ask the patient, join the numbers like 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, you ask the patient to connect all these numbers. The time taken by the patient to connect the numbers is noted. Similarly, the number connection test B. And there is a digital symbol test. Here there is a number and there is a symbol. And there is a 2, there is a symbol. So the patient is asked to reproduce the same symbols as given in the boxes given below. Similarly, there is a serial dot test. The patient is asked to put a dot at the center of the circle. Okay. and then there is a line tracing test. Here there is a gap between the two lines and the patient is asked to follow the line along the shape and draw the line completely. In all these tests, patient the time taken by the patient is noted. In patient with mild hepatic encephalopathy who is clinically normal, otherwise you cannot find out, you can do the psychometric encephalopathy score, where there is obviously the patient takes increased amount of time. This is for detection of mild or grade 1 hepatic encephalopathy. So clinically, what is the other symptom you observe? You observe what is a flapping tremor or called asthrexis. So it is demonstrated with the patient's arm outstretched and the finger separated and hyperextending the wrist with the forearm fixed. So you ask the patient, in a patient with cirrhosis, when there is any altered sensorium, subtle sign of altered sensorium, you perform this asthrexis, flapping tremor test. You ask the patient to outstretch his hand and you suddenly dorsiflex and release the hand. The forearm should be kept straight parallel to the ground. So what do you observe? You observe a rapid, as you can see in the picture, flexion and extension, just like a flap. Flexion and extension movement of the metacarpophalangeal joint and the wrist joint accompanied by lateral movements of the digits. This is called a flapping tremor because it is just like a flapping of wings of the bird. So it is due to impaired inflow of joint and other efferent information to the brainstem reticular formation, resulting in lapse in the posture. So the patient is able to maintain the posture. Because of inability to maintain the posture, there is frequent flexion and extension. Again, the patient tries to regain the posture. Again, there is flexion extension. This is called a flapping tremor or asthrexis. So in a patient with cirrhosis, if he presents with altered sensorium, if there is asthrexis, then patient is in overt hepatic encephalopathy. However, this asthrexis is not specific for hepatic encephalopathy. So this is also seen in chronic, in acute renal failure, in acute heart failure, acute respiratory failure. So in all this, in all the terminal failure stages, you observe hepatic asthrexis. So in a given scenario, patient is non-cirrhotic or patient is alcoholic, the presence of an altered sensorium, you try to elicit the flapping tremor. Presence of flapping tremor indicates patient has overt hepatic encephalopathy. It is because of postural instability. So it is also sometimes called negative myoclonus. So what are the other symptoms which are observed, other signs which could be elicited? They are rigidity. Because the basal ganglion is involved, patient may have rigidity and deep tendon reflexes may be exaggerated. So initially the plantar reflex is flexor and in coma the plantar becomes extensor. So the reflexes become flaccid and absent in coma. Similarly, diffuse cerebral disturbances will lead to excessive appetite, twitching of the muscles, grasping and sucking reflexes. So these reflexes are also called primitive reflexes. Whenever there is diffuse cortical involvement or degeneration of the cortex, these kind of reflexes are observed. And the disorders of vision can be seen, which may induce reversible cortical blindness. So there is always a fluctuating clinical course. Patient may be normal sometimes, patient may exhibit confusion, then patient may be overtly confused and patient may become normal again. So this type of fluctuating clinical course is observed in patients with hepatic encephalopathy. So there is a classification called Westhaven criteria to determine the grade of hepatic encephalopathy. So here is a table which doubles. So here the grade 0 of Westhaven indicates normal intellectual function and normal neuromuscular function. So it is normal. So next is minimal. So normal examination findings and subtle changes in work or driving. Sometimes these subtle changes can be observed by the attendant at home, where they can find that patient is unable to do subtle changes, subtle things at home, like he is finding difficulty in his work or during driving. So here, in minimal hepatic encephalopathy, there are no clinical signs to know whether the patient is really in hepatic encephalopathy or not. Then we perform the psychometric test, psychometric hepatic encephalopathy scoring. Then there is, we can observe or we can ask the patient to draw a diagram to assess the constructional apraxia. So neuromuscular minor abnormalities of visual perception or on psychometric and number tests can be observed in minimal hepatic encephalopathy. In grade 1, there are overt clinical symptoms like personality changes, attention deficits, irritability or depressed state. There is tremor and incoordination. In grade 2, there is change in sleep-wake cycle, lethargy, mood and behavioral changes and cognitive dysfunction. Usually patients with hepatic encephalopathy have daytime somnolence. Their sleep wake cycle is altered. So they try to be they keep awake at night, and they keep on sleeping on the daytime. So you can elicit asterisks, ataxic gaits, speech abnormalities, slow and slurred in grade 2. If there is altered sense level of consciousness, confusion, disorientation, and amnesia, then it is grade 3. Here you can see elicit muscle rigidity, nystagmus, clonus, Babinski sign, that is extensor plantar, sometimes hyporeflexia. And then the fourth stage is stupor or coma, the final stage. So the patient is unresponsive to noxious or painful stimulus, and there is only oculocephalic reflex. This criteria is called Westhaven criteria. This can be used bedside to determine the grade of hepatic encephalopathy. There is another classification called spectrum of neurocognitive impairment in cirrhosis. That is also called SONIC. So here only three categories. It is classified into only three categories. First is normal, where the mental status is not impaired. The special tests, that is the psychometric tests, are normal, and asterisks is absent. Then there is covert hepatic encephalopathy, where the mental status is not impaired. Special tests are abnormal, asterisks is abnormal. So clinically patients look normal, but if you do the special test, they are abnormal. Then it is covert hepatic encephalopathy. Then there is overt hepatic encephalopathy, where there is impaired mental status. Obviously, there will be abnormal tests and asterisks is present. So, covert hepatic encephalopathy corresponds to minimal or grade 1 Westhaven criteria, and overt hepatic encephalopathy corresponds to second, third, and fourth grade of Westhaven criteria. This is easy, isn't it? Covert encephalopathy, when the patient looks normal, but psychometric tests, special tests are abnormal. Overt encephalopathy, when even one sign of hepatic encephalopathy like asterisks happens, now the patient may be in coma. So it is called overt hepatic encephalopathy. This is very important during bedside examination. So what are the differential diagnosis of hepatic encephalopathy? As we have already seen, an alcoholic patient who may be a known cirrhotic or may not be a cirrhotic, he presents you with confusion. Confusion, what is called as acute confusional state, is also called as delirium. Then alcohol presents to you with delirium to the casualty. Then what is the differential diagnosis? Apart from hepatic encephalopathy, on the background of chronic liver disease, if there is an alteration of consciousness, definitely it could be hepatic encephalopathy. So other causes of delirium should also be ruled out in the patient especially in alcoholic patients, like a low sodium state. Patient with cirrhosis and ascites are often given diuretics. So a low sodium state like hyponatremia may produce cognitive mental state disturbances. So acute alcoholism, patient may have binge alcohol and he presents to the casualty where he is confused, the gait is as ataxic or drunken gait, there is slurred speech, picture similar to hepatic encephalopathy. There may be seizures also. So it could be due to acute alcoholism. Similarly, Wernicke encephalopathy. So what the triad of Wernicke encephalopathy is confusion, ataxia, and ophthalmoplegia. So patient with chronic alcoholism have B1 deficiency, iron deficiency, may present with Wernicke encephalopathy. So there is in Wilson's disease. So Wilson's disease may produce which is also called hepatolenticular degeneration, may produce encephalopathy. This is predominantly seen in young individuals. Okay, then subdural hematoma. So an alcoholic in acute alcoholism, there tends to be falls. So patients usually develop hematomas. There is several injuries and patient may have subdural hematoma. So as you can see, this is a CT scan. It shows an acute subdural hematoma. Whereas here, the CT scan shows a chronic subdural hematoma. These subdural hematomas may sometimes occur with trivial trauma and they may go unnoticed. And patient may present with confusion, a delirious state, altered sensorium. So this has to be differentiated with hepatic encephalopathy. And hypoglycemia. The most common cause of altered sensorium in any alcoholic patient is hypoglycemia. Because when the patient drinks alcohol, alcohol gives only calorie requirement, but it does not increase the glucose levels. So it doesn't take the food. So leading to hypoglycemia. And also liver disease. If the patient has liver disease, glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis are impaired. So whenever there is decrease in the sugar levels in the blood, there is no counter mechanism to increase the levels of glucose. So it may lead to hypoglycemia. So all these are differential diagnoses. So you have to keep in mind. And patients, especially in alcoholic patients, without underlying liver disease, presents to the emergency with a delirium or a confusional state. So how do you diagnose hepatic encephalopathy? Always clinically. Hepatic encephalopathy is always diagnosed clinically by clinical examination. You elicit the neurological signs. You elicit asterisks. You look at the tone. You look at the reflexes and extensor response of the plantar, and you can perform the psychometric and hepatic encephalopathy score, and you clinically diagnose hepatic encephalopathy. Certain changes are observed in EEG and other imaging techniques. We can also take the help of all these things to diagnose hepatic encephalopathy. So imaging, you see CT, MRI, and there is something called MR spectroscopy, where you measure the resonances of various biomolecules, various chemical molecules in the brain. Then you can watch for the evoked potentials, like brainstem evoked potential, visual evoked potentials. These evoked potentials are nothing but electrical signals which are generated when subjected to sensory stimulus. Suppose if there is visual stimulus, there is visual evoked potential. You measure the visual evoked potential. Similarly, if there is an auditory stimulus, you measure auditory evoked potential. So these are mostly of research interest, but not used clinically. CSF analysis. You can do a CSF analysis. What you find in CSF analysis is increased proteins and increased glutamic acid levels. We have already seen in the pathophysiology, increased ammonium levels, there is increased deamidation of glutamate to glutamine, which further converts to glutamic acid in the presynaptic neuron. So there is increased level of glutamic acid. So in EEG, what you see in EEG, suppose the patient is cirrhotic and he doesn't have any overt signs of encephalopathy. If you perform an EEG and if he is in encephalopathy, there is synchronous slowing of wave frequency with an increase in the amplitude. The frequency decreases, the amplitude increases from a normal alpha rhythm 8 to 13 cycles per minute to a delta range of below 4 cycles per second. As you can see in the picture, if the patient is alert, the frequency is 8 to 13. As the clinical state deteriorates, the frequency decreases and the amplitude increases. And if the patient is in hepatic coma, then there are triphasic waves with increased amplitude. And if terminal stage, there is only one flat line. So these are the EEG changes. These may be seen prior to patient developing any clinical symptoms of hepatic encephalopathy. So coming to the imaging techniques. In imaging techniques, we have CT and MRI. So what do you observe in CT and MRI? So as you can see, this is a T1 image of T1 MRI image, where there is hyperintensity in the basal ganglia at the putamen level. This is thought to be due to deposition of the manganese. So this sign is characteristic of hepatic encephalopathy. Sometimes when the astrocyte is affected, what happens? There is increased infusion of ammonia into the astrocyte. So the astrocytes, there is increased osmolarity. There's increased water influx into the astrocyte, leading to edema. Sometimes there is cerebral edema, diffuse cerebral edema. So this diffuse cerebral edema is also seen in the CT or MRI. So this is what is called as MR spectroscopy. So in MR spectroscopy, it is a technique where you measure the levels of different molecules in the brain. So it is also called resonance of molecules. So this is N-acetyl state. And this is choline, this is creatinine, this is glutamate and glutamine, and this is inositol. This graph shows various levels of compounds in the MR, in the brain, in MR spectroscopy. So glutamine and glutamate levels increase due to influx of ammonia into the astrocyte. So there is a relative peak of GLX, glutamine, glutamate, in the MR spectroscopy in patients with hepatic encephalopathy, and relative decrease in the choline. This is the normal and this is a relative decrease in the choline. So whenever glutamine levels increases, there is outflux of myo-inositol into the outside of the astrocyte. So there is relative decrease in the inositol levels. So these are some of the characteristic findings in MR spectroscopy, which may be seen in patients with hepatic encephalopathy. So we have seen what is hepatic encephalopathy, what are the clinical manifestations, what are the pathophysiology of hepatic encephalopathy, what are the clinical manifestations, And how do you find out whether the patient is an encephalopathy or not? By clinical examination and by various tests, investigations. Now we'll see how do you treat the patient with hepatic encephalopathy. So as we have seen in patients with chronic liver disease, the major patient goes into hepatic encephalopathy only if there is any precipitating factor. So first we have to correct the precipitating factor. Precipitating factors are excess diuresis, hemorrhage, paracentesis, diarrhea, vomiting. So all this, what they cause, they decrease the perfusion of the liver. The liver cell has already failed and it is unable to detoxify the ammonia into urea. Now when there is further decrease in the perfusion of the liver, it may precipitate hepatic encephalopathy. Similarly, alcohol excess. Alcohol is a toxic to the liver. So any accumulation of excess toxin may lead to hepatic encephalopathy. Sedatives like benzodiazepines. We have already seen there is increased GABAergic tone in the brain in hepatic encephalopathy. So these sedatives, the benzodiazepines, occupy the same GABA channel and increase the chlorine influx, leading to hyperpolarization and inhibition. This may lead to hepatic encephalopathy. Then sepsis, infection of the pulmonary, urinary infection or spontaneous bacterial peritonitis may precipitate hepatic encephalopathy. Portal systemic shunting. So in a patient with increased portal hypertension, we go for a portal systemic shunt. Sometimes the shunting of blood itself may precipitate hepatic encephalopathy because the ammonia which is present in the portal circulation is directly shunted to the systemic circulation. It will go to the brain and exert it inside if there is any excess dietary protein intake, because nitrogen is the byproduct of protein metabolism. So all these precipitating factors, you have to find out what is the precipitating factor for hepatic encephalopathy and treat it accordingly. Then the second part comes, treatment of hyperammonemia. So you have to decrease the level of ammonia, because ammonia is a direct neural toxin which is causing all the damage and all the clinical manifestation. We do it by two methods. One is non-absorbable disaccharidases. So the non-absorbable disaccharidases like lactulose or lactitol can be given. These non-absorbable disaccharidases, they pass through the small intestine and reach the colon. In the colon, so this act on the bacteria. The bacteria act on these disaccharides, and then it produces an acidic environment in the colon, leading to decreased absorption of ammonia. We'll see the mechanism in the next slide. Then gut antibiotics, which are non-absorbable. There are some antibiotics which are not absorbed through the intestine. So they stay in the intestinal compartment. So there are some urease producing bacteria in the intestine. So they split the urea into ammonia. So thus increasing the level of ammonia. So these antibiotics act against those bacteria and cause decreased level of ammonia. So how does lactulose therapy act in decreasing the level of ammonia? So when lactulose given, it is not absorbed or not split in the small intestine, it passes into the large intestine. In the large intestine, the lactulose is converted into lactic acid. So the pH ultimately decreases. And the pH decreases, the ammonia which is in the blood and the colon diffuses into the lumen, and it combines with the protons to form ammonium ion. This ammonium ion is excreted outside. Similarly, there are other mechanisms why how the lactulose decreases the ammonium levels. One is, as we have seen, by decreasing the pH. Similarly, the lactulose is fermented by the colonic bacteria producing volatile fatty acids, VFA, and hydrogen and methane. So whenever there is accumulation of gas and decreased luminal pressure, it triggers catharsis, that is evacuation of the bowel. Similarly, the ammonium which is present in the blood is dragged into the colonic lumen. It combines with H+ ion to form ammonium ion. Similarly, the volatile fatty acids utilization results in bacterial proliferation. So bacteria, they come into the gut lumen and start proliferating. So while proliferating, the bacteria utilize the ammonia for the nitrogen of ammonia for themselves. So for proliferation. So they incorporate the colonic ammonia nitrogen. So the proliferating bacteria and the ammonia is present in the stool. They together form the stool. And because of the decreased pH and increased osmolarity, there is catharsis. So and there is gas formation. There is increased passage of a stool from the colon into the rectum, and it is passed into as feces. So all these mechanisms contribute to the decreased level of contribute to decreasing the level of ammonia in the blood. So decreased pH in the colon, production of ammonium ion, and then bacterial growth which utilize the nitrogen of the ammonia, and proliferation, all these lead to catharsis, leading to elimination of ammonia from the blood into the gut and then outside. So we have seen how do you treat the precipitating factor, then you treat the hyperammonemia. So suppose the patient has minimal hepatic encephalopathy, what you want to do? You should avoid constipation because it increases the ammonium levels. You should avoid the precipitating factors. There should not be excess diuresis, patient shouldn't have diarrhea, vomiting, patient should have adequate stool formation, and you maintain adequate protein and energy intake. Then, if required, you give non-absorbable disaccharides like lactose 20 to 40 ml daily or lactitol 10 to 20 grams per day. Lactose is the liquid form, lactitol is a second generation disaccharide which is in solid form. So it can be taken 20 to 20 grams per day to have regular bowel movements not to precipitate any hepatic encephalopathy for the patient. Suppose the patient has acute hepatic encephalopathy. Suppose the patient is having chronic liver disease, he is having ascites, then he has severe abdominal pain and fever. There is spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Then patient may go into acute hepatic encephalopathy. So you have to provide general supportive measures. You have to identify and treat the precipitating factors. Here, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis is a precipitating factor. You have to identify and treat it with IV antibiotics. Clinically, the target is the patient should have at least 2 to 3 soft stools per day so that the hyperammonemia levels are decreased. So for this, you can give enema every 6 to 12 hours for 40 to 70 hours. So you have to maintain protein and energy intake. So the energy intake is 35 to 45 kilocalories per kg. The proteins like 1.5 to 2 grams per kg should be given to the patient. The non-absorbable disaccharides, as we have discussed, lactose 40 to 120 ml per day. We usually start with 15 to 30 ml per day. Then we increase the dose. Or lactose 20 to 40 grams per day daily. If the response is inadequate, then you give an antibiotic, non-absorbable antibiotic like rifaximin. This is available in different strengths like 300, 400 and 550. 550 mg you give twice daily, 400 you give thrice daily. Or neosporin, 4 to 6 grams per day. Neosporin is minimally absorbed through the gut. However, long-term administration of neomycin has been associated with ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity. Hence, rifaximin is the safer drug to give, either 400 mg TDS or 550 mg BD. So between the episodes, if necessary, you should avoid precipitating factors and maintain adequate protein and energy intake. So you can continue the lactose and lactitol so that further episodes are not, you should prevent the further episodes. Suppose the patient has persistent hepatic encephalopathy. The patient is continuously having grade 1, grade 2 hepatic encephalopathy. Then you have to see that you have to avoid all the precipitating factors, maintain protein and energy intake. Usually, protein should be from vegetable source rather than from animal source. Okay, and consider probiotics. So there is in cirrhosis, in any diseases nowadays, there is a dysbiosis in the gut. So the altered intestinal flora contributes to all the problems. So if you replace them with another type of flora by giving probiotics, there is a decrease in the symptoms are noted. So you can consider administration of probiotics. And non-absorbable disaccharides can be given like lactose or lactitol. Okay. So non-absorbable antibiotics like rifaximin and neosporin. Better to give rifaximin. So if the response is inadequate, what do you want to do? So you give the non-absorbable antibiotic rifaximin 1.2 grams daily. Then branch chain amino acid supplements. So there are certain supplements like branch chain amino acids, LOLA, that is L-ornithine and L-arginine. All these are, they are, they activate the enzymes of urea cycle. These help in activation of urea cycle. Whatever residual urea cycle enzymes are there, they try to activate and help in the detoxification of ammonia into urea. So we have seen that there is decreased dopamine levels in the brain. So bromocriptine, which is a dopamine agonist, can be given 7.5 milligrams daily. And sodium benzoate is used in patients with urea cycle enzyme defects. So these help in scavenging the ammonia. Suppose sodium benzoate converts the nitrogen in the ammonia to heparic and it is eliminated in the urine. So the ammonia which is generated can be diverted to other products and eliminated in the urine with the help of sodium benzoate and daily enemata. Usually patients respond very well with lactulose and rifaximin. If the response is inadequate, then you go for the branched chain amino acid supplements or L-ornithine, L-arginine supplements, sometimes bromocriptine, sodium benzoate and regular enema. So still there is poor response, then you go for revision of the surgeries. We have seen that photosystemic shunting may itself precipitate hepatic encephalopathy because there is lot amount of blood shifting, portal blood is shifted to systemic circulation which contains lots of ammonia. So it may lead to damage to the brain or blockage of any large spontaneous shunts. If there are any spontaneous shunts, you try to block them. If still the situation is unresolved, then you go for hepatic transplantation. If there are other indications, so you have to see whether the patient is a candidate for transplantation. Then you go. Suppose if there is acute fulminant hepatitis, patient has acute fulminant hepatitis, the hepatocellular failure, the INR is prolonged, there's hepatic encephalopathy, and he is a candidate for liver transplant, and there is a liver transplant available, you prioritize the patient and go for hepatic transplantation. Usually in cirrhosis, usually 50 to 70% patient responds well. And especially when there is photosystemic shunting, then you have to think of hepatic transplantation. So this is the treatment. We have seen treatment for minimal hepatic encephalopathy, acute event of acute hepatic encephalopathy, and persisting hepatic encephalopathy. The main goals are treating the precipitating factor, then treatment of hyperammonia. Treatment of hyperammonia includes non-absorbable disaccharides, lactulose and lactitol, and non-absorbable gut antimicrobials like rifaximin and neosporin. If neosporin is avoided nowadays, then other compounds can be tried like branched chain amino acids, L-ornithine, L-arginine, sodium benzoate, and bromocriptine or regular enema. So this completes the topic. Just to summarize, so hepatic encephalopathy is a neuropsychiatric syndrome seen in patients with liver cell failure. So it occurs in 50 to 70% of patients, cirrhotic patients, and it is a poor prognostic indicator. So usually in a patient with chronic disease, there is always a triggering event, inciting event. So you have to identify the trigger and treat it. In the pathophysiology, when there is hepatocellular disease, there's decreased detoxification of ammonia leading to hyperammonemia in the blood, which causes damage to the brain. Cerebrum, basal ganglion, cerebellum are the major parts affected in the brain, leading to spectrum of manifestations from mild cognitive, mild intellectual impairment to a coma. So how do you diagnose? It is mainly by clinical examination. You look for presence of asterixis, foetor hepaticus, and other clinical symptoms. And if the patient has mild symptoms, you go for psychometric hepatic encephalopathy score, where you use the dots connecting test and pattern drawing test to know the if the patient is taking increased amount of time, he is definitely having grade 1 or minimal hepatic encephalopathy. You can take the help of other tests like EEG, where there is gradual slowing of the waves with an increase in amplitude. Triphasic waves are seen, which are characteristic. Then in imaging, you have hyperintensity is noted in the basal ganglia. Then if you do an MR spectroscopy, there is increased glutamine and glutamase peaks, decreased choline peaks, and decreased inositol peaks. Then you investigate treatment includes the precipitating cause should be treated, and then you have to treat for the hyperammonia. Precipitating cause include excess amount of diuretics, or diuretics are given in excess amount, you have to stop them. Then you have to replace with fluids. If there is diarrhea, vomiting, you have to correct the abnormality. If there is an infection like spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, infection of the lung, infection of the GI, infection of the urine, urinary tract, you have to treat them. Then you have to avoid constipation. Then drugs may be precipitating the disease. So you have to avoid all the drugs which may cause the disease, like sedatives. Similarly, then you treat the hyperammonemia by using non-absorbable disaccharides and non-absorbable antibiotics like rifaximin. Certain drugs like flumazenil. Flumazenil is used as benzodiazepine antagonist. May be tried, because in benzodiazepines they act by GABA channel, GABA A channel, where they increase the chloride levels, entry of the chloride. So if you give a benzodiazepine antagonist, sometimes a response may be seen. So flumazenil is a benzodiazepine antagonist. So these are the treatment modalities. So this finishes the class. So if you have any doubts, please ask me. Please ask if you can put your questions in the chat box.